Let's continue our study of perfect and oversized arrays by examining a split method. Well, first off, let's talk about what split does. This method was inspired by a method that's in the string class. Now, the string class method uses something called a regular expression, a fascinating part of computer science, but unfortunately something that's beyond the scope of our class. The signature for this method depends on how we allocate the array, so we'll discuss what it should be a little bit later. What split should do, for example, is to take a string like ABC, DEF, GHI, and return an array containing three different strings. The first, ABC, it stopped at the C because of the white space, then DEF, and it stopped there because of the white space, and lastly, GHI. Now, this array might have three elements, which would be perfect, or maybe it could have more, and that's where the complication comes in with the signatures. So let's talk about strategy number one, and that's a perfect size array. The idea here is you construct the array to the perfect size, but this is a little challenging because in order to construct an array the perfect size, you have to know what the perfect size is. So you basically have to compute the size in advance, and then you can't change the number of elements. The signature of the method will be this, string square bracket split from string source. So source is going to be the string, sort of like the ABC, DEF, GHI in the last slide, and the string array is what's going to be returned. Now in this case, the string array has to be the perfect size, because if it isn't the perfect size, we don't know what size it is, and that's going to make it difficult to interpret. Now the length of the array that's being returned is going to be returned in the .length field. So this is kind of a sneaky way of returning two things. We get the array and its contents, but also the length. So we're getting a little two-for-one deal here. So let's talk about what the algorithm will be. The first thing we have to do is to figure out the size of the array. Now we can use a scanner for this. We've done this trick before where we use a scanner to break up a string based on white space. Then we allocate the array to the perfect size, and then we store the result in the array. Now, unfortunately, what we have to do at this point is to go through again with the scanner and rescan the whole string. Now, in the case of three little strings, this is an insignificant amount of effort. If there are more strings, this might be a problem, though. Let's take a look at the code. So here's our split method. It's returning a string array, and it's taking a string called source. So the first thing we do is we use the scanner to break up the source. Now we need to keep track of how many elements are going to be in this breakup because that's how we'll know how to allocate the array. So we create a variable called count, we set it to 0, and while input has next, we read input next. So this way we'll read, separating at white space every single time, and we'll know how many elements should be in the array. The next thing we do is we allocate the array to the perfect size. So this is string square bracket result equals new string of count. So now we have the perfect size array. The only thing we have to do is to recreate that scanner object by reconstructing it and then stepping through it one more time. Only this time, instead of just adding one to count, we're going to put the data into the array. That's what the second for loop does. And the last thing we do, of course, is to return result. So notice we're having to duplicate our efforts here. And this is a problem that tends to occur with perfect size arrays. Now here's strategy number two, called an oversize array. This is the strategy that's used in the ArrayList class, so it might sound a little bit familiar. You use the strategy if the size of the array can't be known in advance, or if it has to change. The fact that it has to change is the case that causes the ArrayList to be done like this. So what you do is you construct an array with extra space in it. We call this capacity instead of size. And we often put in lots and lots of extra space. Now that extra space can be a problem too. Even though our computers and even our cell phones now have a lot of memory, when you're an engineer, you don't want to be wasteful of any kind of resource, even if that resource is memory, because eventually it will cause problems. Then we have to keep track of how much the array has been used in a separate variable. This I usually call the active part of the array, and I usually use the name size for it. So now we've got two things, the array reference, which has an array allocated with a certain capacity, an extra large capacity. And then we have this integer variable called size that's keeping track of how much of the array has been used. So here's an example of an oversized array. First, we allocate the integer array data to 10 new positions. We set size to 0. And then we're going to put the data 1, 2, 3 in the first three positions. Now notice those are indices 0, 1, and 2. That's what that I minus 1 is doing in the loop. So when we're finished, our data array has 10 positions, but only the first three have been used. Our variable size, on the other hand, it contains the value of 3. And so that tells you that three positions in the array are actually alive at this point in time. Now let's think about what the signature for split is going to have to look like. We know we're going to have to return the number of elements in the array because we have no way of pre-calculating that. So that means the return type for the method is going to have to be an int. Now this presents a problem because we've got to get that array back too. And we know we can't return an array allocated in a method. Well, we could return it as the return type, but remember we're only allowed one return type. And since our return type has to be int, it can't be a string array. So this is a problem. The array has to be allocated in advance, that is before the method starts, and then passed in as a parameter. That way we can use it. Now, if this strategy isn't clear to you, make sure you listen to the next lecture in this series, because it's going to go through this decision in enormous detail and show memory diagrams of what would happen if you tried to do this. So here's what the signature is going to have to look like. Int, split, string source. So the string source is the same as it was in the other case. And then we have to pass in an array, string square bracket result. And that array has to have already been allocated. Let's take a look at what the code would look like. Now, the first thing you'll notice when you look at this code is it's quite a bit shorter. The reason it's shorter is because we don't have to calculate the size in advance. Our result array has already been allocated. So we create the scanner from the source string and then step through it one at a time. Now, you'll notice that the for loop here has one extra condition in it. It has to go through while input has next, but also we can't step off the end of the array. So that's what index less than result.length is doing. So by checking those two conditions, we make sure that we have enough space in our array. Then at the end, we just return index. So it's quite a bit simpler to do it with the oversized array, but the signature looks a little funny. So let's make a comparison here. For the perfect size array, we have to scan the string twice. What's more, the size of the active part of the array is the capacity of the array, and the array was allocated inside the split method. With the oversized array, we only scanned the string once. The capacity of the array was larger than the size of the array, and the array had to be allocated before the method. So the way you allocate the array makes a huge difference in how this computation is done. Keep programming.